Astronomers are always looking for new phenomena. We have a catalog of about 100, 150 different things in astronomy. Red giant stars, sun-like stars, white dwarfs, neutron stars, black holes, spiral galaxies, elliptical galaxies, dwarf galaxies, giant galaxies, and so on. But we haven't found everything there is. There are classes of objects that exist in astrophysics that we have not yet found. And we know this with certainty. Now, how do you find something absolutely brand new? The bottom line is you find new things by building new kinds of telescopes. I'm Michael Shara, curator of astrophysics at the American Museum of Natural History. I've always been interested in the structure and the evolution and the births and deaths of binary stars. The Sun is a single star, living in isolation for the last 4.5 billion years, but about half of all stars are born with a companion. And as stars evolve, as they burn up the hydrogen in their cores, they tend to swell in size. And so stars that initially aren't interacting with each other do start to interact. And that leads to a fascinating set of phenomena, including nova explosions, supernova explosions, and other wild and crazy things that stars do. That's what I study. Nova explosions occur in binary systems where one of the stars is just like the Sun, but its companion is the corpse of a star, an older, more massive star that is turned into a tiny Earth-size object that starts to cannibalize matter from its companion. Novae brighten to a million times the brightness of the Sun. It doesn't lead to the destruction of either star. Supernovas are the destructions of stars, the deaths of stars. It can be a single, very massive star that collapses under its own weight, or it can be a binary star, where you have one star dumping matter onto another one so fast that it collapses, or perhaps two stars merging to form an object that's too massive to hold itself up. They blow themselves up, destroy themselves, eject themselves into space at 5, 10, even 20% the speed of light, and they leave behind either a super dense neutron star or, in the most extreme case, a black hole. These deaths of stars can be seen halfway or more across the universe via the Hubble Space Telescope. The Hubble Space Telescope remains one of the two most powerful telescopes ever built. And of course, the Hubble telescope has now been joined by the James Webb Space Telescope, operating in the infrared part of the electromagnetic spectrum, whereas Hubble is a visible and ultraviolet telescope. And so these two telescopes work in beautiful synergy, sometimes looking at the same object or the same class of objects to understand what's going on. Over the last several years, I've been really fortunate to be involved in a brand new project in astronomy called the Condor Telescope Array. Up until around 1900, all telescopes were refractors, telescopes that operate very much like a pair of binoculars, a lens which captures light, focuses it onto an eyepiece. By around 1900, astronomers ran into a hard limit. You can only make a refracting telescope about 1 yard across. If it gets any bigger, it starts to sag under its own weight, so you can't keep the image focused. And so astronomers basically discarded refractors and started working with reflecting telescopes only. A reflecting telescope is a mirror, and that curved surface of a mirror captures incoming light, brings it to a focus. And today there are telescopes that are 10 times the size of the largest refractor ever built. They have 100 times the light collecting area. And so they're vastly more sensitive than any refractor ever built. But refracting telescopes have certain innate advantages over reflecting telescopes. In particular, reflecting telescopes, they're noisy. Their images have scattered light in them. So about 10 years ago, a group of astronomers realized that, it's true that we can't compete in terms of collecting area to be able to see faint stuff with refractors, but we can buy lots and lots and lots of refractors in the form of telephoto lenses right off the shelf, very cheap. And in the last 5 years, the same kind of camera that's used in your cell phone have become big enough to become competitive with the cameras, which have been the norm in astronomy for the last 40 years. When you combine these two kinds of technologies together, you can create new kinds of telescopes. And it turns out that you can see the very faintest things in astronomy, what we call low surface brightness objects, better than you can with reflecting telescopes. And there is now a Condor telescope array, 6 refracting telescopes, up and working in New Mexico. I'm really fortunate to be part of it. We've just found the funding to build a copy of it in Chile, up at 18,000 feet in the Andes, at one of the most superb astronomical sites in the world. And these two arrays of telescopes are going to allow us to survey the entire sky, the northern and the southern hemisphere, in particular narrowband filters, in particular filters that let us get rid of all the extraneous light and focus on the light emitted by diffuse gas ejected from novas and supernovas, and maybe even the filaments of dark matter that run through the universe.